Hello everyone, myself Chirag Kale would like to welcome you all for a video session on geothermal energy. Now this particular topic is in module number 5. Your module number 5 can be broadly classified or broadly divided into 4 parts. The first is geothermal energy, then there is ocean thermal energy conversion, tidal energy and wave energy. In this particular topic, I will be only talking about geothermal energy. Now, initially, we should know how much is the marks distribution given to those particular topic. So, I will be just going through the marks. So, the entire module, that is module number 5, you will be having it for around 20 to 30 marks in your end semester exam. Out of which, there will be a definitely 15 to 20 marks theory and 5 to 10 marks numerical. So, in the first topic, that is geothermal energy, it consists of around 8 to 10 marks of theory. Numerical may not be asked from this particular topic, that is what I feel, but still we will be touching on to the numericals. But as of now, from all these particular topics, the least important type of numerical is from geothermal energy. Okay, it may not be asked, but still we will be touching on to those particular numericals. Then I will be talking about OTEC in my next video, where it is about 8 to 10 marks. And from this topic, as well as from the tidal energy, from these two particular topic, we can get a numerical. That is what I feel. And the numerical will be only for 5 marks. And the last is wave energy, which only consists about theory part. Okay. So again, I repeat the things. For geothermal energy, there is theory, 8 to 10 marks. Numerical may be asked or may not be asked. For OTC and tidal energy, there is both theory plus numerical. Numerical of 5 marks may be asked from these two particular topic, that is OTC and the tidal energy. Fine. Let's move ahead. Now, geothermal energy, what exactly we are going to study? So the first and the foremost thing, what is geothermal energy? Sources of geothermal energy. Then we'll move on to what are the different kind of sources like hydrothermal, geopressurized, hot dry rock, magma. What is exactly magma, advantages, disadvantages, application and its scope in Indian prospect. Fine. So these are the few topics that we are going to touch today. The important thing is application for power generation that I will be talking about. It is very important from understanding point of view as well as from the examination point of view. So let's move ahead. Okay, now coming to the introduction part, what exactly is your geothermal energy? So it is simply the heat inside the earth in simple terms. Now, why there is this heat inside the earth? Now, as you all know, initially your earth was a hot sphere of gases, which then evolved into solid hot sphere. And then it is now right now it is a habitable planet. But that particular heat is still stored inside our earth crust, which is in the form of magma. Again, there are few radioactive elements which radiates energy and it keeps on getting heated up. And also there is a friction among that magma which flows inside the earth. So these all things causes the inner core to get heat up. As you can see, the temperature range that we particularly see is around 5000 degrees Celsius at the center of earth, which is around 6000 kilometers at the 6000 kilometers depth. We are not concerned with that much high temperature. Even if we get around 200 degrees Celsius, it is quite enough to generate power. And that is why our geothermal energy can be used in power generation. Now moving ahead, what are the sources of geothermal energy? So the first, everyone must have seen hot water springs. Okay, they are even to our close vicinity, they are located at Vajreshwari or even Satyuli in our neighboring areas. There are hot geysers. A geyser is nothing but it is a combination of water plus steam. A hot spring is nothing but there is a hot water. A fumarole is nothing but a hot steam plus hot gases. Now these gases can be anything, that is it can be even your sulfides, that is hydrogen sulfides, which are quite harmful for the nature. Volcanic eruption. Volcanic eruption is nothing but the active volcanoes which is in the form of magma. Okay, so these are the few types of major sources of geothermal energy. Now where this geothermal energy is found? So this geothermal energy is generally found near the boundaries of your tectonic plate. Now as you all know, there are n number of tectonic plates, and due to the movement of the tectonic plates, there is something known as earthquake. Okay, so generally this geothermal energy is very much found in the region of, that is, earthquake prone area. Fine. So let's move ahead and see what is a typical geothermal field. Now, this particular diagram shows you the typical geothermal field. Now, as you can see, at the bottom there is something known as magma volume. Okay, that magma heats up a igneous rock. Now, igneous rock is exactly what is formed after the solidification of your magma. Now, this is your igneous rock, which one can see over here. Above it, there is something known as porous rock. Now, what is exactly this porous rock? Now, whenever there is a solidification taking place on your earth sphere, there is a certain cavity which can get created. Okay, in that particular cavity, there can be a water which can be trapped inside. Now, as the temperature is very high, it can be the form of your steam, or it can be in a form of water depending on what the temperature is over there. So that is nothing but your hydrothermal field. That is part number three, that is hydrothermal field. Now, above it, again above the cavity, there can be again a rock, which is again a solid rock can be there. Okay, and through that solid rock there can be a cracks known as fissures. Okay, there can be even hot springs through which your hydrothermal field, which contains water, can escape onto your surface. Okay, so those all things that we saw in the previous slide, which talked about your what are the sources like hot springs, or even your hot springs, your foam rolls, your geysers, tend to escape from this hydrothermal field onto the surface through this immersible rock, and that is where we get a geothermal energy. Now, even if there is no fissure, that is, even if there are no gaps created in this particular land, we can still extract the geothermal energy from inside a hydrothermal field. That is a research topic known as HDR. I will be just touching on to that also, that particular topic, in this particular session also. Now, types of geothermal resources. There are four types of generally geothermal resource that we are going to touch upon. Those are hydrothermal. Now, as you saw in the previous slide, this particular field which is visible over here is nothing but your hydrothermal field. So getting energy out of it, which is nothing but a cavity where we can get hot water as well as steam, and getting that energy, getting it converted, is known as hydrothermal field. That category is particularly known as hydrothermal geothermal resource. Okay, hot dry rock, again, if there is a cavity, as you saw in the previous slide, if there is a cavity but there is no water, still the rock temperature will be pretty high. So using that particular thing is known as HDR. Geopressurized is nothing but whenever there is a hydrothermal field, your water can be at high temperature and pressure. So that pressure also will be utilized in geopressurized field, and that pressure plus temperature will be used to run a turbine. So that is geopressurized. And everyone knows magma. It is nothing but a hot liquid which is present inside the earth core, and energy from that can also be utilized as a geothermal resource. Now let's go on to your advantages. So what are the advantages? Advantages, it is highly efficient. I mean, we can get efficiency of a very good order, better than that in your OTC plant as well as your tidal plant. It is reliable. Your solar energy, the main drawback, it is not reliable, but this particular thing, it is very much reliable. You can get 24 hours ka energy. It is clean. There is no pollution, or there is no greenhouse gas effect. But still, there are few gases which are emitted in the environment and which are quite harmful. So one has to look after it. It is again a renewable source of energy. How it is renewable? So if I get the water, that is a hot water, out from it, I use it to run a turbine, and I can again put it inside. The energy in the magma is quite high. Okay, so it will keep on heating up that particular water over a period of time. Hence, it is a renewable energy source. We can save our fuels. It can decrease our dependency on foreign oil. Again, there is no transportation involved. Whenever on the particular site itself, where there is a geothermal site, we can put a power plant, and that can be used to generate electricity. Now, going ahead, there are again few disadvantages. The disadvantages is, can't provide our current energy need. The source is quite less, and also it is very geologically active area. Okay, so it can be only used in geologically active area, that is near the boundaries of your tectonic plate. It cannot be used everywhere. Water which we extract contains corrosive materials or corrosive gases inside it, which are dissolved in the water, which can harm your system. Again, The gases are very, I mean, they are very active gases, and leaving it directly in the environment can harm your environment. A piping system is required, and the initial cost is very high of this particular. Now, coming on to application of geothermal energy. Now, geothermal energy can be used from a temperature range of right from say 20 degree Celsius to 200 degree Celsius, depending on what application we want to use it. We extensively use it for power generation. Apart from power generation, it can be used for various processes. Like for 20 degrees, it can be used for fish farming, where a 20 degree temperature is quite good for increasing the yield of fish. It can be used for swimming pools to heat up the swimming pools, for de-icing of even your roads, road sideways, where the temperature in the cold cities is quite low, and there can be an accumulation of ice due to which there can be a slippery surface formation. So, de-icing of that particular thing, soil warming to increase the yield of agriculture, air conditioning, that is for vapor absorption system, we can even use it. That is vapor absorption system in place of generator, we can use the source of geothermal energy as a heat. Okay, there are various processes, drying. Even your cold storage, your space heating is a main application of geothermal energy in cold countries. Now, the space heating, generally we use an electric heater, but in place of electric heater, we can replace it with a geothermal source. It is free of cost, and it will increase the temperature of that particular space and make it more easier for a human being and more habitable for the human being. So, moving ahead. Now, hydrothermal sources. This is the most important topic. If any topic from this particular chapter, from examination point of view, if the question is asked, it is from this particular topic. That is, from these three, one will be asked, that is for definite. Okay, one of the topics will be asked from these three particular topics. So the first, what is hydrothermal resource? We have already discussed it out. Okay, whenever there is a cavity formation, there is some liquid, there is some gas which get traps inside. When that particular hot liquid or gas tries to escape, that is steam tries to es gets, I mean, it escapes from the surface. We use it to generate power or for various other applications that we saw previously. And that hydrothermal resource can be used to generate power. Now, how the power generation takes place is in by these three particular ways. The first is dry steam power plant, that is vapor dominated. Then there is a wet steam power plant. In that, there is a flash steam power plant and binary cycle. So we will see in brief what are these three. So let's see one by one what are these three types. So my first thing is vapor dominated or dry steam power plant. Now, as the word suggests, vapor dominated. It says that your geothermal source has produced a vapor. Vapor in the sense it is nothing but your steam. So the steam from your inside hydrothermal resource is brought onto your surface. Okay, now this can be brought naturally or there can be a drilled well through which we are getting your steam like a borewell. Okay, so it can be anything from geothermal zone. I am getting this. Okay. Dry steam. Now the temperature of your dry steam is about 200 degree Celsius. For this particular vapor dominated system I'm talking, the temperature is around 200 degree Celsius. Now this 200 degree Celsius and the pressure is also high because it is a hydrothermal resource. That is, it is trapped inside Earth's surface. So definitely the pressure is going to increase because the cavity is of same size, whereas due to heating of the liquid, it has formed into steam, so the pressure inside is high. So if the temperature is around 200 degree Celsius and the pressure is around 8 bar, we can use this particular system. Vapor dominated because the vapor is dominating in this particular case, and dry steam because this steam is particularly dry. There is no dryness fraction. Okay, this is somewhat superheated or the dryness fraction is not present, that is x is equal to 1 if I take in terms of dryness fraction, and then only this particular system can be used. So talking about the system, my steam initially is taken up from the geothermal zone, okay, in an upward direction I am taking it. It moves. Okay, now there is something known as centrifugal separator. Now what does this centrifugal separator do? So the steam which is brought from inside the earth may contain some particulates, okay, or even there can be some gases which are somewhat heavier than that particular steam. सो इन सेंट्रिफ्यूगल सेपरेटर वी ट्राई टू सेपरेट पर्टिक्युलरली सॉलिड मैटर थ्रू इट. ओके, द सॉलिड मैटर विच इज बॉट अलॉन्ग विद द स्टीम कैन बी सेपरेटेड यूजिंग अ सेंट्रिफ्यूगल सेपरेटर, दैट इज दिस पर्टिक्युलर पार्ट. आफ्टर दिस आई कैन डायरेक्टली सप्लाई दिस स्टीम टू अ टर्बाइन. ओके, नाउ द कंपाउंडिंग मे बी रिक्वायर्ड, मे नॉट बी रिक्वायर्ड डिपेंडिंग ऑन द टेम्परेचर प्रेशर, बट एज ऑफ नाउ वॉट वी आर कंसर्न इज इट गोज इन टू योर टर्बाइन. ओके, टर्बाइन, इन टर्बाइन वी हैव कपल्ड द टर्बाइन विद द जनरेटर. सो द स्टीम इट रोटेट्स द टर्बाइन, द जनरेटर प्रोड्यूसेस द पावर, एंड देन द एग्जॉस्ट ऑफ दैट पर्टिक्युलर स्टीम इज पास थ्रू अ कंडेंसर. ओके, कंडेंसर, सो अगेन देर इज अ कूलिंग वॉटर, दैट इज नथिंग बट अ कूलिंग टावर. ओके, एंड देन इट इज यूज्ड, वी यूज अ पंप एंड देन वी सप्लाइड बैक टू द सोर्स. नाउ इन सम केसेस इवन इफ वी डू नॉट सप्लाई इट बैक इट इज ओके, बट देर इज सम केमिकल रिकवरी दैट नीड्स टू बी डन, बिकॉज योर स्टीम मे कंटेन सम हार्मफुल केमिकल्स विच आर डायल्यूटेड इन साइड इट, और हार्मफुल गैसेज विच आर डायल्यूटेड इन योर स्टीम. So we have to get rid of those. So if we are using it, we have to do a chemical recovery. If you are not using it, we can directly inject inside the geothermal source from where we have taken it. So is this process same to, is this process similar to something? Yes, it is. It is similar to your Rankine cycle. How? So let me talk. There is a generator. Where is the generator? Generator itself is your geothermal zone. After generator, it is turbine. After turbine, it is condenser. After condenser, it is pump. So this is nothing but a Rankine cycle which is run in order to produce power. So that is, that was about vapor dominated dry power, dry steam power plant. Now some important things that you should know. First of all, this is the oldest way that we learned to extract geothermal energy. Okay, now it can directly be run using a pure steam. Okay, we can directly use a pure steam and we can run this particular system. Pure steam itself drives the turbine in this particular thing. So there is no auxiliary parts required in order to drive the turbine. Okay, so this kind of plants, even you can just YouTube it and you will find many of the videos of this particular plant. They are operational plants in California, Italy and Japan. And this California one is the most oldest plant which runs on this vapor dominated or dry steam power plant technology. Fine with this? Now let's move ahead. Now the second type that we are going to see is nothing but your flash steam. So what exactly do you understand by the word flash steam? Now initially in dry steam power plant the temperature was around 200 degrees Celsius. Here if the temperature is a bit low, that is say around 170-180 degrees Celsius, we'll be using this particular type of system. So what exactly happens over here? So over here again there is a geothermal zone from which we are trying to extract some steam. Okay, now this steam in particular is at lower temperature, so but obviously it will be a wet steam, there will be some dryness fraction, that is x will be less than 1. Okay, so in order, if I use the same steam to run a turbine, your turbine blades may get damaged. So in order to protect it, we use something known as flash chamber. This particular thing is known as flash chamber. Now what exactly is flash chamber? So in flash chamber, the pressure is comparatively lower. Okay, so that when the steam enters, there is a sudden expansion. So due to sudden expansion, like your throttling effect, maybe when there is a sudden expansion, your water, your steam will get vaporized because the pressure is low. Correct? At low pressure, the temperature for boiling is also low, so it will vaporize and some liquid will also get, it will get removed out to the into your flash chamber. Okay, so there are like baffles through which, these are the baffles through which it will try to flow. Okay, and due to that the vapor will be dried enough to run a turbine after this particular thing. So flash chamber is a chamber where pressure is comparatively low and there is a flashing of steam. So due to the flashing of steam, the liquid present, the liquid can be removed out. You can see over here, this black particular section is nothing but that particular liquid which is removed. Okay, and that is hot brine, that is a concentrated mixture of your water and salt, and that can be again poured back into your system. Now, what we get is a dry steam after a flashing. So that particular dry steam can be run, can be used to run a turbine. Again, turbine coupled to a generator, which can be used for power generation, condenser, and condenser, if at high pressure it has to be again put into the put in your geothermal source, there should be a pump, or else we can directly put it, because there is a gravitational gradient always associated, so that can be used. And even in this particular system, you may ask why there is no pump, because we generally do not do chemical recovery of what we have got out. Okay, there is no chemical recovery over here. We put everything inside the geothermal source or the hydrothermal source from where we have collected it. So in this particular case, we do not need a pump, because of the gravitational gradient only the system can run itself. Fine. But in actual practice, there will be a pump, because while getting it up from the source itself, there has to be some pressure. Okay. That pressure will be produced by the pressurized hydrothermal source. If that is not enough, we will be using a pump in order to extract that steam. Fine with this. So this is about the flash steam or high temperature wet steam power plant. Now this is wet steam, as I said, your dryness fraction will be always less than 1. Now the third is, if the temperature is also low and the steam is wet. This is was about high temperature. If even the temperature is lower, say the temperature, okay, prior to it, we will just go through the glimpses of what are the flash steam power plant glimpses. So this is the most common geothermal power plant that we can see across the world. Okay, here there is a mixture of hot water as well as steam. Okay, pressure changing system is nothing but your flash chamber. And these plants, there are operational plants in Hawaii, Nevada, okay, and some other places. So these are quite operational plants. You can just check a video on YouTube saying that flash steam power plant, and you will find a number of videos of these working projects. Fine. Now let's move on to our third part, that was our binary cycle power plant. So in binary cycle power plant, as the word says, binary. Binary ka matlab kya hota hai? Do. ठीक है, टू थिंग्स. सो व्हाट इज टू एग्जैक्टली ओवर हियर? सो देर आर टू लूप्स, ओके, बाय विच वी कैन जनरेट पावर. एंड व्हाट इज देर इन टू लूप्स? टू डिफरेंट फ्लूइड्स. ओके, सो द फर्स्ट लूप दैट यू कैन सी इज नथिंग बट अ वेल दैट इज इन द हाइड्रोथर्मल रिसोर्स दैट रन्स राइट थ्रू द जियोथर्मल थ्रू अ हीट एक्सचेंजर एंड इट इज बैक इंजेक्टेड इन टू योर वेल. करेक्ट. सो दिस इज योर जियोथर्मल hydrothermal resource or geothermal zone through which I am getting some wet steam of a temperature around, say, from 90 degree to 170 degree. Fine. I am passing it through heat exchanger. Now what is on the opposite side of heat exchanger is your refrigerant. Okay, why refrigerant? Because refrigerant generally have low boiling point, so I can easily vaporize them. So over here it is written isobutane. Even isopentane can be used. Even all the refrigerants that commercially we use, we can use any one of it, depending on what temperature I am getting. Okay, the only thing is it should get vaporized at that particular temperature. So using that refrigerant, I am running another cycle. Now how it goes? It goes like your another cycle is moving. That is, I am heating up this isobutane vapors, that is refrigerant. I am running a turbine. Okay, this is my turbine. Using it, I am running a turbine. This is known as organic Rankine cycle, because I am using an organic fluid over here to run the cycle. Now that is coupled to a generator. Fine. Now the remainings are passed through a regenerator. Why regenerator? In order to increase the efficiency. As you all know, some of the heat which was still left out can be used in a regenerator. Then that particular thing is passed through a cooling tower pump, and this loop is continued in this particular manner. So that was my first loop. This is my second loop. I will just change the color so that it is more visible correctly. Okay, so this is my second loop. That was my first loop. So since there are two loops and two fluids, it is known as binary systems. Okay with this? So these three are the most important topics from end semester examination point of view. I again repeat the same thing, that one of the questions from this particular topic, that is from these three, vapor dominated, wet steam or flash system, and this binary cycle, one of the topics is sure to be asked from this particular topic. Okay, fine. Now the last thing, just I want to give an introduction to what is HDR. that is hot dry rock, sometimes it may happen that there is no steam or there is no water present in that particular cavity. Okay, so if there is no water or no steam, how we can extract heat? So what we do is, but there will be definitely a hot rock, the temperature of the rock will be very high. So what we do is we make a well, like your bore well, similar to your bore well, we make a well through which we inject certain fluid. Okay, so here as you can see, okay, so from here we can inject it. Okay, so that is not visible, so I will just change the color. Okay, we are injecting something. I have injected it, and from that hot dry rock I am taking some heat. Okay, I am extracting that heat and I am taking the water back up. Okay, I am taking that water, I am extracting that particular heat, and I am then trying to pull that water inside my system again. Okay, so what I do, I inject some water, and even after getting the heat, that injected water can be taken back. Okay, so that water will definitely increase its temperature. Now that particular thing is passed through a heat exchanger, because this is in a closed loop. This particular thing is a closed loop, is passed through a heat exchanger. That heat exchanger will definitely increase the temperature. If it is a very high temperature, I can use water as a fluid. If it is not very high temperature, I can use some refrigerant as a fluid, that is organic Rankine cycle, and we will run a Rankine cycle over here, and then we can generate power. So this was about HDR, that is hot dry rock. Here there won't be any water, we will be extracting heat only from the hot rock. That is why it is said to be hot dry rock, because there is no water associated to it. It is dry, the temperature of the rock is hot, high, so it is known as hot. Okay, so that is nothing but hot dry rock HDR system. Fine with this? Okay, let's move ahead. So what is the scope of geothermal energy in India? Now when it comes to India, geothermal energy plays a very important role. It can play an important role. We are blessed with certain geothermal sites. Okay, the estimate is that we can produce around 10,000 megawatts of power. Okay, but as I said, it is very site specific. Okay, so which are those sites? So the most promising site is Puga Valley in Ladakh. Okay, this is the most promising site where we can extract geothermal heat. There are n number of springs present over there, even there are geysers present over there, through which we can we can build up a power plant and generate power out of it. Our GSI, that stands for Geological Survey of India, has identified 350 geothermal energy location. Even one at Vajreshwari, even one at Satyuli is identified as a location for a potential geothermal energy source that can be developed out of it. Fine with this? Now, this all work started right from 1970s. From 1970, GSI started their surveying. They came up with around 350 sites all over India, correct? And they found out that we can produce around 10,000 megawatts. Now, again, there are also different sites which are much favorable and which can be used for geothermal apart from Puga Valley. Those are your Himalayas. At the basis of Himalayas, there are hot spring and hot geysers at various places like Kedarnath. Even your Sohana, that is near to the Delhi, your west coast areas like our Satyuli Vajreshwari, Kambe, Son Narmada Tapi, that is your Son Valley, basically known as Sonata in the, nearer to the your Son Valley, that is nearer to your Saputara ranges, okay, your Godavari and Mahanadi basins where we found these geothermal sources. So right now we haven't developed any plant particularly in India, but we have a huge potential that we can trap and we can use it as a renewable energy source. But the main basic problem will always remains the same, that is the high capital cost, and even the technology needs to be somewhat advanced in order to be used in particular. Fine. So this was about the theoretical part of this particular topic. Now I would like to give you a quick introduction about the numerical. Generally, a numerical from this particular topic won't be asked such in your examination, but you should know what are the numericals. Okay, there is only one kind of numerical which was asked like 2 times in last 10 years, so we will just go through it quickly. So let's move on to our numerical. So let's start with the numerical. Again, I would like you to make a point that this particular topic, the numerical, has been only asked twice in last 10 years. They are not as important as that in your tidal energy as well as your OTC. But still, you should know the basic type of numerical. It is very simple numerical. It requires only your second year thermodynamic concept. Okay, so let's move on to the actual numerical. So the numerical goes as a geothermal site of size 70 kilometer square. Now, size is 70 kilometer square. What does it indicate? It indicates the area. Okay, this particular term indicates your area. It is in kilometer square. Okay, and the depth is 2 kilometers. Fine. So if I go as there is an area, okay, and there is certain depth associated with it. So if there is an area as well as depth, okay, so area is nothing but length into breadth, into your depth is nothing but your height, so that will give you a volume. Okay, so this particular data will help me to get the volume. Now this volume can be used in order to calculate the total volume of my geothermal source or geothermal zone or your hydrothermal resource. Fine. Has a temperature of 240. So that particular geothermal zone has a temperature of 240 degrees Celsius. Fine with that. And a volumetric specific heat. Now you all know specific heat at constant pressure. That is written generally as CP. Okay. What are the units? Kilojoule per kg Kelvin. Over here it is given as volumetric specific heat. Now it is in terms of mass, that is kilojoule per kg. Over here, if it says volumetric, it will be given in joules or kilojoules per centimeter cube or per meter cube. That is the volume. So it is in terms of per volume. Okay, that is why it is known as volumetric specific heat. Fine. Find energy content in joule if the surface temperature is 30 degrees Celsius. Okay, so the surface temperature at the top is 30. My geothermal field temperature is around 240. And how many years the site can provide power for a 2500 megawatt power plant if the conversion efficiency is 1.6. Okay, so let me first clear the scenario. What is the scenario? There is a certain geothermal field. There is a certain geothermal field. Okay, which has certain volume, which is the volume of that particular hydrothermal resource. It has a temperature of around 240 degrees Celsius. That is the temperature of that particular volumetric, that particular geothermal field. Okay, the surface temperature, which is the temperature of the surface, it is 30 degree. Fine. So now you have a volumetric specific heat, okay, you have a volume, fine, and you have a temperature difference. So you know a formula which is quite similar, which says mcp delta t, correct? But when there is m, you have a specific heat in terms of kilojoule per kg Kelvin. Here it is in terms of kilojoule or joule per centimeter cube or meter cube. So that will be giving me total energy content of that particular geothermal field. Fine with this? Now that particular heat which is stored in that particular geothermal field is extracted out, and from that I am trying to run a power plant which is about 2500 megawatts. Okay, 2500 megawatt power plant I am trying to run using that geothermal field energy. Now if that is the total content of the field, if I know the total content, then I have to find out for how many years will I be able to run a particular power plant, fine, of capacity 2500 megawatt. Now there is one more thing which is given, saying that the conversion efficiency is 1.6%. Okay, so what does that exactly mean is, I can, out of the total energy, I can only convert 1.6% of the total energy. Fine with this? Now let's move on to the given things one by one. So the area, as I said, it is given in kilometer square. I have to just get converted it into meter square. Okay, so that is written over here, that is 17 into 10 raised to 6 meter square. The depth is 2 kilometers. So again, I am converting it into meters, which goes around 20,000 meters. Okay, sorry, 2,000 meters. Then my temperature of the ground is given as 240 degrees Celsius. That is of my geothermal field. Okay, the volumetric specific heat, it is denoted with the letter C. It is given as 2.51 joules per centimeter cube. Now, every time just remember one basic funda, that is always convert everything into your SI units. Fine. See, the area I have converted into meter square because meter is the SI unit of length, correct? Or of area, fine? Then, depth again in meters, temperature is in degree Celsius, volumetric specific heat, it is given in terms of joule per centimeter cube. So, that centimeter cube has to be converted into meter cube. Now, it can be written as joules per meter cube per degree Celsius, or it can be written as kilojoule per meter cube per degree Celsius. Okay, just I have converted it into kilojoules because to keep the value low, and I will get answer in kilojoules in the later part of my problem. Okay, now the power plant capacity is given as 2500 megawatt. That is the power plant I am running using the energy from the geothermal field, and I have given something known as conversion efficiency. So how much energy of that geothermal field I can convert into power plant, energy that can be generated by the power plant. Fine. So starting with the solution, then the first and the foremost thing and the most easiest thing is to find out the volume. Volume of what? Volume of my geothermal field. This particular field which has a certain area, certain height or certain depth. So the volume is equal to area into depth. Fine. That is, I am finding a volume of a cuboid, which is nothing but length into breadth into height. That is, length into breadth is your area into height, that is your depth. It is given over here in the question itself. So it comes out to be 1.4 into 10 raised to 11 meters square, meter cube, sorry. I make my pardon, it is 1.4 into 10 raised to 11 meter cube. Fine with this, that is the volume. Now, second part, once I get the volume, I will try to find out what is the total energy contained in that particular volume. In order to get it, I am given something known as specific heat or volumetric specific heat, being more precise. So my volumetric specific heat into my volume into my temperature difference will give me the total energy content. Fine. The total energy content is given as V into C into Tg minus Ts. This formula, again I repeat the same thing, it is similar to mcp delta T, that is the energy content, but since here the volume is given, the volumetric specific heat is given. Fine. You can just cross check the units and you will be coming out with the unit of kilojoule, because I am taking C in terms of kilojoule. So my answer will be in kilojoule. So this is my answer which I was getting, that is 7.3 into 10 raised to 16 kilojoules. But in my question itself, it has been said that energy content is in joules, to find energy content in joule. So in order to get it, I have just converted in terms of joule. Fine. Fine with this particular thing, why I have converted into joule again. Fine. So now I have found out total energy content. This was the first part of my problem. The next part says that I have to find for how many years I can run a power plant of 2500 megawatt. So in order to do that, first let us understand some scenario. Now there is something given as conversion efficiency. Conversion efficiency means the efficiency with which I can convert my energy content in a geothermal field to a power plant. As simple as that. Fine. So, the total energy content, whatever is my total energy content, out of that I can only convert 1.6%. Okay. The total energy content, I can only convert 1.6% of it. So, my actual energy will be what? Total energy content into 1.6%. That is 0.016. So I am getting around 1.18 into 10 raised to 15 kilojoule. Now this is the actual energy that can be converted and used to run a power plant. Fine with this? Okay. So this is the energy for power plant. Now next thing, what is the capacity of power plant? My capacity of power plant is 2500 megawatt. Correct? So this 2500 megawatt is in terms of mega joules per second. Can I say mega joules per second? Fine. So I have to get it. In my question itself, it is given that how many years side can provide power. So I have to find per year. So in order to do that, I have to convert mega joules per second into, since maybe in joules per year or kilojoules per year. फाइन, बट सिंस माई टोटल एनर्जी इज किलो जूल पर ईयर, आई विल बी कन्वर्टिंग इट इनटू किलो जूल पर ईयर. फाइन विद दिस. सो इन ऑर्डर टू गेट इट कन्वर्टेड इनटू किलो जूल पर ईयर, व्हाट आई हैव टू डू इज योर 2500 मेगावाट कैन बी रिटन एज 2500 इंटू 10^3 किलो वाट और किलो जूल्स पर सेकेंड. ओके, सो 2500 इंटू 10^3 इंटू, इफ आई वॉन्ट टू कन्वर्ट जूल्स पर आर, आई विल बी मल्टीप्लाइंग विद 3600. नाउ पर आर आई एम कन्वर्टिंग इंटू पर डे, सो इंटू 24 पर डे आई एम कन्वर्टिंग इंटू पर ईयर, सो दैट इज 365. फाइन, सो आई विल बी कमिंग आउट विद द आंसर ऑफ 7.88 इंटू 10^13 किलो जूल पर ईयर. नाउ दिस इज द एनर्जी दैट इज रिक्वायर्ड पर ईयर टू रन अ पावर प्लांट ऑफ 2500 मेगावाट. फाइन, सो इफ दिस इज द एनर्जी पर ईयर एंड आई नो द टोटल एनर्जी, करेक्ट, सो टोटल एनर्जी में से ये पार्ट हर साल कम होते जाएगा. फाइन, सो इफ आई ऑर्डर टू, इफ इन ऑर्डर टू फाइंड आउट नंबर ऑफ ईयर्स, वॉट आई कैन डू इज द बेस्ट पॉसिबल वे, जस्ट आई हैव टू डिवाइड दिस टू नंबर्स एंड आई विल बी गेटिंग नंबर ऑफ ईयर्स. दैट इज माई एक्चुअल पावर विच इज 1.18 इंटू 10^15 डिवाइड इट विथ वॉट इज रिक्वायर्ड पर ईयर. सो पर ईयर इट विल बी 7.88 इंटू 10^13, इट इज आई एम डिवाइडिंग दिस टू टर्म्स, ओके, इन ऑर्डर टू गेट नंबर ऑफ ईयर. फाइन, सो इट कम्स आउट टू बी अराउंड 14.97 ईयर्स, और बींग मोर प्रिसाइज इट इज 14 ईयर्स एंड 354 डेज. सो दिस इज द न्यूमेरिकल विच वॉज आस्क्ड टू टाइम्स इन योर प्रीवियस 10 ईयर्स, ओके, लास्ट सिंस लास्ट 2014, सिंस लास्ट 2011 इट हैज बीन ओनली आस्क्ड ट्वाइस, बट इट इज वेरी सिंपल, इट जस्ट रिक्वायर्स योर बेसिक कंसेप्ट ऑफ थर्मोडायनामिक्स, देर इज नथिंग एल्स, देर इज टोटल एनर्जी कंटेंट एंड नंबर ऑफ ईयर्स दैट इज रिक्वायर्ड टू रन अ पावर प्लांट. इट इज क्वाइट सिंपल न्यूमेरिकल, आई होप एवरी वन हैज अंडरस्टूड दिस पर्टिकुलर प्रॉब्लम. ओके, अगेन आई वुड लाइक टू थैंक एवरी वन फॉर देयर पेशेंस. I hope this video session was a fruitful one, and I mean you have gained some good knowledge about the numericals as well as theoretical aspect of geothermal energy. Again, if there are any doubts, you can contact me on WhatsApp or you can even put a mail. Thank you one and all. Have a nice day.